What's happening, everybody? I'm Tommy C, and I'm going to give you a roundup of all the social media news that was going on this week that's actually interesting. Let's start it off. Vovax this week got into it with Angelica Oles, pointing out that she, too, like Gabby Hanna, has used Bianca Devin's name in a video. This after Angelica Oles said, "I never use B's name for clout, not in the title, not in the thumbnail, not in the tags. I reported on a story that many people sent in. No one from B's family reached out to ask for an apology, so my assumption was they didn't want one, didn't want to continue dragging this on." Our tweet reading Fred Bovax went to point out that this simply was not the case, taking a screenshot of one of Angelica's videos showing that she used Bianca Devin's name in her video. Now you're probably saying to yourself, what's the big deal? But this situation has to do with Gabby Hanna, about a controversy that happened a couple years ago that is seemed to resurface in recent weeks. Gabby was making a video about a video she was going to make, and she was looking for clothing styles and fashion styles that e-boys and e-girls were wearing. She used a picture of the deceased Bianca Devin. And a lot of people in the T community, a lot of people on YouTube use this to point out on how insensitive it was. And while it definitely was worth criticism, Gabby Hanna did reach out to the family and was completely forgiven. Multiple tweets and videos saying that this was an honest mistake. But YouTubers, T community types, and the Gabby Hanna hate crowd just can't seem to deal with it. They almost seem to want Bianca Daniels' family to be upset and angry about what now is starting to look like a mistake. I mean, does anybody really believe that Gabby Hanna did this on purpose? Certainly, it's a legitimate criticism to say that this is, you know, you should have read the text in the particular article about the person you were talking about the clothing style you're trying to capture. But certainly, this wasn't done on purpose. Now, in fairness to Angelica Oles, she did kind of own up and apologize to Bovax. She wrote on Twitter, "It has come to my attention that I did have Bianca's name in my thumbnail. It was not for clout or attention, but I could see how it could be used in that way. So both have been blurred. Thanks for bringing this to my attention." What seems to be so strange to me, this is an ongoing trend on YouTube, when you're talking about a serious situation, in some cases, you shouldn't be allowed to utter the victim's name. Now, this is a case of trying to, or being hoist by your own petard, where you're trying to point out that Gabby Hanna is using a dead girl for views, and nobody under any circumstance should utter this name. That's why you see Angelica Oles typing B's. Actually, that sounds a lot more disrespectful. If you're going to do a story about a murder victim, I think it'd be a good idea to say their name. This is one of these strange things on YouTube, these weird ethic rules that mainstream media certainly doesn't have to follow, or anybody reporting a story on a murder victim doesn't have to follow, but some reason we do. This whole thing is really stupid and out of control, but it gets better. YouTuber Nick Snyder seems to be one of these people that is just can't deal with the fact that the Devin's family is not upset with Gabby Hanna, well over a year after it's been settled. Watch Nick Snyder come up with a completely wild conspiracy theory to hold his worldview together, his really worldview of hate for Gabby Hanna, and come up with a conspiracy theory why the Devin's family has been so forgiving. But also, having watched the video from the family, I'll say it seemed a bit off. I've never seen a mother use a word clout in T-Channel so much. Gabby Hanna wanted to write something for Jesse to read, so why not anyone else to further her narrative? My conspiracy, allegedly. Now, if you watch my podcast, Shot from the Point here on Tommy C's SFTP, you know I went nuts on Repzilla for something similar, but this is much more egregious. The fact that so many in the T community and the Gabby hate train can't accept the fact that the Devin's family actually knows something that they don't, called forgiveness, and is not a part of the cancel culture lifestyle that is Twitter, is actually kind of repulsive. Why do we have to believe that somehow Gabby Hanna fixed this whole situation and these people aren't decent and realize that Gabby made an honest mistake? No, we have to dream up conspiracy theories, how they've been manipulating, and for what? What did they have to gain? They actually had a lot more to gain by becoming victims and saying that Gabby did something egregious. YouTube newsman Tipster decided to call out Nick Sinner on Twitter. Kind of disrespectful to be questioning the intelligence of a family of a murder victim. Nick Sinner responded to Tipster, "Oh look, another narrative trying to be painted. You are clearly lacking something essential, like a clue. So let me make this simple. I'm saying I find it kind of weird, someone who isn't on social media dropping buzzwords like T-Channel and Count after speaking with Gabby Hanna." Yeah, that's what's disrespectful, you moron. The fact that you're questioning their intelligence and that Gabby Hanna is just this mass manipulator and otherwise they would be on the T-Channel side. That is what's disrespectful. That's what he's saying. You didn't provide anything new. That's what your original tweet said, and you responded to the criticism with the exact same statement. You're a rocket scientist. Here's another thing. The Devens family's daughter was an influencer. T-Channel, clout, that really isn't too difficult to come up with if your child is actually in that field. Bianca Devens' mother is 3 years younger than me. I think she knows what clout and T-Channel means. Super Smash Brothers drama channel / news guy / the future of commentary tentacles dropped a video called The Truth Behind the Sky House featuring Sky and Zero # apologize to Sky. This is a big video release. It got over 100,000 views and it talks about what happened to Sky Williams in the Sky House. And that's not a lot of the things we've been hearing about him are just either simply not true or over exaggerated. I highly, highly, highly recommend that you check out this video. There's a lot of nuance to it. We can't go over it today, but please check it out. Also got to interview Technicals yesterday on my Shot from the Point live podcast. You can check that out as well. And as the curtain gets lifted in Sky Williams and people are demanding apologies for having him labeled as the Jeffrey Epstein of Smash, of YouTube, he writes this on Twitter, "Almost broke 1K viewers today. I couldn't believe the support I got. It's actually effing unreal. I can't wait to be debt free. Big ups to Technicals for the continuous raid. I'll be back tomorrow, hopefully earlier. Good night, y'all." After being falsely labeled every evil thing in the book that you can possibly think of, Augie, Bobax, myself, Nick DiOrio, and of course Technicals, who's done a great job in actually repairing a lot of things deserving so in Sky Williams' reputation. He deserves to make a living, and I really, again, I can't stress enough, please go see that video. And if you like, support Sky, and for some reason you bought into the lies, maybe she give him another chance. Jesse Smiles does not want Gabby Hanna making a video using, quote, her trauma and clips of her crying about 2 weeks after she made a video about Gabby Hanna using her trauma and clips of her crying. Press F to pay respects. Rest in peace, dog meat. River, the German Shepherd that inspired the German Shepherd in Fallout 4, Dogmeat, has passed away. And we do give our great respects for this beloved caveman. In some extremely tragic news, Twitch streamer Mikey Perk, his daughter, has gone missing. She's 17 years old. Her name is Sarah. You might have seen the hashtag Find Sarah. Apparently, she snuck out of the house and she has neither been seen or heard from since.
She's worried about the repercussions, and I just want to send a message directly to you, Sarah. If you're out there, I want you to know that we just want you home. Everything can be worked out. Everything can be salvaged. We want to listen to you. We want to understand what's going on. We love you. Yes, we're hurt, but we want to have you home. And the other thing is, if you do have her, if you know where she's at, please help us. Please. Please help us get her home. If you can share this and maybe this can reach her, that'd be amazing. And so then I hope you have a great day, great night, and let's find Sarah.
Police departments all over Ohio are looking for Sarah. Keemstar put out a tweet, and I'm going to read it here for you. If you have any tips about Sarah, please dial 1-937-425-2525. 1-937-425-2525. And let's # find Sarah. So spectacular news. Friend to Shot for the Point, Josh Pugliot, has just been announced to be a voiceover for the up-and-coming Nickelodeon cartoon Avatar. We are very proud and excited to announce that Josh Pilliot has attached himself to our flagship series, Avatar, The Legend of Ronin. He will be voicing the mighty Chief Extol, hope I'm saying that right, of the Sun Warriors. Go ahead and subscribe to his YouTube and Twitch channels and keep your eyes out for more announcements to come. This is exciting for me personally. I've conducted two interviews with Josh. Josh, if you didn't know, made a joke in a RuneScape game several years ago, and that joke actually resulted in him being arrested and being convicted of being a domestic terrorist, despite having no arms in his house at the time. Now, Josh has to be really thankful right now, but I know he's really thankful for folks like yourself. Not necessarily the Shot from the Point crowd, but definitely you could thank you as well. But the fact that the internet came together to reasonably well publicize his story. If you take a look at this story, it is a clear example of government overreach and a district attorney that just needed a conviction. It goes without saying that it's extremely difficult for convicted felons to get jobs in general, much less a job in entertainment. And that's why I know Josh is so thankful to the internet, to people like yourself, to spread the word. Because again, if you look at this case, it's government overreach, it's heartless district attorneys that just needed to make an example of a young man who spent much too much time in prison. There's some unverified allegations out there that Austin McBroom owns Social Gloves, the corporation that put on the YouTuber vs. TikToker boxing event. And apparently, none of the boxers have been paid up until this point. But those unproven allegations haven't stopped YouTubers of accusing Austin McBroom of not paying his boxers. Tana Mojo decided for some reason to chime in. She wrote on Twitter, "Not Austin McBroom owning most of Social Gloves, and then everyone being surprised people aren't getting paid." Austin McBroom fired back hard. "Not the most desperate human being speaking on she doesn't know about. Don't try to bring me or the event down to make you feel better about TanaCon. Every fighter, including myself, will be getting paid, and a lawsuit is happening. And it's not with Social Gloves, dumb dumb." Ah, sick burn. But Dexterito tries to straighten out the McBroom situation as far as ownership goes. They write, "While Austin himself hasn't spoken publicly about ownership in Social Gloves, a quick search of the United States Patent and Trademark Office directory shows that Social Gloves is owned by a McBroom-owned company. The owner of the Social Gloves trademark is an Ace Hat Collection Incorporated. The CEO of the Ace Hat Collection Corporation is, of course, the Ace family, Austin McBroom, with wife Catherine listed as a secretary." So what is clear is that Austin McBroom definitely has a stake in the Social Gloves company. But what is not clear is Social Gloves responsible for paying for the boxers. After all, he did talk about a lawsuit, almost like he was a part of the lawsuit. So we don't know that, but I do know if I ran TanaCon, I would never make a crack on Twitter like that. Trisha Paytas not too happy about Gabby Hanna parodying her in a recent thumbnail on her channel, The Gabby Show. Trisha writes on Twitter, "Gabby using photoshopping herself in Frenemy's thumbnail is what stalkers do when they're obsessed with somebody. She did it with Bo Burnham to lie that she was dating him." Trisha, it's a parody. The Gabby hate train is a very long train, and there's a lot of people that can fit in. Kat Tembridge is apparently a conductor from Insider Magazine. She wrote, "Are you allowed to use YouTube original logos like this? It seems to be the kind of thing YouTube would discourage." Hey Kat, it's a parody, you snitch. Wrestler Booker T was in a lawsuit with Activision over his alleged inclusion of his G.I. Bro character. As you can see to the right over here, this was the Call of Duty Modern Warfare 4 character. I wouldn't say it looks all that much like, no, not at all. But yeah, this is a poster for a movie, a Zora poster that Booker did, and the court found that they're just not that much alike. Some YouTuber engagements to announce. Friend of the show, Tony D2 Wild, the sneaker YouTuber, apparently he is tying the knot. And of course, iDubbbz eloped with his new wife, Anissa Ajoma. That's right. They have finally tied the knot after being together well over 5 years now. All right, that's all I got for you. The video is getting a little too long. I could get into Indie Fox getting banned again and all that other stuff, but I think it's been pretty informative. And in fact, on Thursday, we'll have Dr. Zhivago and Matt Pitt, and we'll go over a lot of these stories that we went over so far and some of the stuff that I left out. Thanks so much. We'll see you soon.